Hey guys, my name is Jason with Mount Baker Mining and Metals, and on today's video, we're going to be smelting down some 14 karat gold jewelry, and we're going to try and refine it down to just precious metals. So let's get started, and I'll show you the process.
So here's our jewelry. I've got a little ring band here with no stones in it, and then a little, like a bracelet, I guess. They're both stamped as 14 karat gold, and when I purchased them, they were supposed to be 5.5 grams. So the first thing, let's make sure I actually bought 5.5 grams worth of gold. So 5.5. Okay, so we got the right amount of gold. Now let's take a look at how much I spent on it. I paid $205.63 after tax. We'll take a look at our chicken scratch here. We got 5.5 grams. That's what I paid for it. So for 14 karat gold, 205.83 divided by 5.5. That's what I paid per gram for this material, $37 and roughly 50 cents. Right now, spot price for 24 karat gold is $59.79 per gram. So to figure out how much I paid per gram of gold, 14 karat gold, spot price of pure gold times 58.5% is how much gold is in 14 karat gold, is $34.98 per gram of gold spot price, if that makes sense. Now, interestingly enough, I paid 37, so I paid a little like 250 more than the spot price. But if you take out the tax, if you notice on my receipt, I paid 189 for 5.5 grams. I actually paid a little bit less than spot price for the amount of gold that I bought. So don't get me wrong, I'm not going to be making a whole bunch of money on this one, but I was surprised that going to a pawn shop and buying scrap gold, I bought it roughly for the scrap price of the gold. So I was surprised there. I thought they'd mark it up a little bit more. All right, our first step is going to be taking our jewelry, putting it in this enormous crucible here, and I'm going to melt it down into a button. And this is actually, I don't need to do this step, but what I want to do is I want to get it melted down into a button, both pieces, and then take it to the scrapyard and have them zap it with the XRF gun so we can know exactly what metals are in here and how much we get at the end so we can figure out how much more pure we have it after our whole process. Little bit of borax in there. Take it and put it in our furnace, like so. Now let's light it. When you're smelting and you're going to pour your charge into the cone mold, it's important to have your cone mold dry. So I'm here in this shot, I'm preheating my cone mold. I'm driving off all the water because if you pour a bunch of 2000 degree liquid glass and metal into a cold cone mold with moisture in there, it spits and pops and shoots that molten stuff everywhere. So it's really important to get your cone mold dried out and preheated a little bit before you do your pours. Okay, well, moment of truth here. The borax is all shattered. It's cooled down quite a bit. So let's see if we can get it to pop out of there. There we go. It's probably still hot. But there is our gold button. Here's a little closer look at the slag. It's pretty clear. You can see through it. Kind of got a little green tinge to it. Maybe just a little bit of iron in there. Iron usually makes that green color. So I wanted to talk a little bit about the furnace itself. It's made out of KO wool, and I've been getting a lot of emails from you guys, both saying that you want to start smelting and try it out, but also a lot of people are telling me with comments and emails about how dangerous that stuff is, that KO wool, especially after you fire it, those long fibers are needle-like,
And if you start breathing them in, they get in your lungs, and it's just like asbestos. So they've been telling me, you know, be careful. A lot of people are saying that I should coat my furnace, and I have in the past. I've done that a couple different times. But it seems like the stuff that I'm smelting, all those sulfides, some of that metal, I don't know if it's something in the sulfides that it eat that coating away really quick. And so the coating just doesn't last very long. But another word of caution is the KO wool fibers are dangerous. I'm not trying to downplay that. But there's stuff coming off those sulfide cons that are equally as nasty, if not worse. You got heavy metals such as lead, zinc, copper, arsenic. Stuff like that that might be coming off there. And then the flux that you use, I use a lot of basic or alkaline flux. And so you got this really alkaline rich smoke coming off that if you breathe that in, it starts eating away your stuff. So I always wear a respirator when I'm running, when I'm smelting, regardless of if I'm just smelting a little bit of gold like today, or if I'm smelting lead or whatever. So just be safe, you know, don't take that stuff for granted.
Okay, let's see if we have our 5.5 grams here still. 5.41. So we lost like a tenth of a gram. Some of that could have been from the melting process, oxidizing some of the base metals in there as it melted and got up in temperature. The other thing could have been, there could have been, I don't know, a little bit of dirt or some other junk in there that went off into the slag. But now I'm going to take this and see if I can get it zapped with the XRF gun. We'll figure out exactly what metals are in here.
All right, now we're going to go into our next stage, which is the actual refining stage. We got this figured out. This is actually 14 karat gold, as we thought. There's a lot of copper, and there's a little bit of zinc that I'm going to try and pull out of this thing. And the way I'm going to refine this, I'm not going to use any acids. I'm going to use the cupelling method. This is a cupel. We're going to put the gold in the cupel. I'm going to add a bunch of bismuth. I use bismuth. You can use lead as well. There's not really any rule for how much bismuth or lead to add, but I can tell you that copper and nickel are two metals that are a little bit harder to cupel away than lead or, you know, your other iron or stuff like that. So I'm going to be adding quite a bit of bismuth to this ratio wise. I'm going to add, for this 5.5 grams, I'm going to add about 20 to 30 grams of bismuth. And what happens is I put it in the electric furnace. It heats up to about 1800 degrees Fahrenheit. And I open the door, I crack the door just a little bit to allow oxygen to flow into the furnace or fresh air. And as that puddle of bismuth gold alloy is exposed to the oxygen, the bismuth oxidizes and the bismuth oxides are liquid at that point. And so they roll off the bead of metal, the alloy, and they're absorbed by the cupel. The cupel is porous to oxides and it's impervious to metal. So the metal alloy stays stuck or sitting on top of the cupel, and all those oxides run off into the cupel and are absorbed. As the base metals get less and less in the alloy, the oxides look like little tiny raindrops on top of the surface of the metal alloy in the cupel. And those things are, it's really cool to watch. They just kind of dribble off the side. And once that stops, completely stops, you have your precious metals refined and there's no more base metals. Now the bismuth, as it oxidizes, carries with it all those other impurities, the copper, the zinc, the iron, anything in there, as long as you have enough bismuth to kind of overwhelm and carry those other base metals away. And what we're going to be left with is only the precious metals. So we're going to have the gold and the silver. They're going to be left as a molten bead in the cupel. And once the whole process is done, there won't be any more base metals to be sucked out or oxidized away. It'll freeze. And then we can get it retested. But at that point, you won't have any other base metals in there. A lot of people ask if the cupels can be reused. They cannot. Once they get filled up with oxides, they can't be reused. Another common question is, can you recover the bismuth or the lead out of the cupels? Yes, you can. I have a video on that. I'll post a link here or a card up in the corner, so you can click on that if you want to watch that process. I don't, just because the bismuth and the lead, they're not worth enough to go through the whole process.
Okay, there it is. Let's see how much it weighs. There's about 63% gold and silver in that 5.5 grams. So I think that comes out to just under 3.5 grams is what we should get. There we go. So I bet you 98-99% of our base metals are out of there. Now, the other thing that I'll mention is you don't have to smelt this down in a crucible and with the borax and stuff. You could actually put that jewelry right in a cupel, right into the furnace with a little bit of bismuth, and end up with the same thing. I just did that. I wanted to get it coalesced into one button so we could get it analyzed with the XRF, but you could very easily just put the scrap jewelry in a cupel and remove the base metals that way. Let's go get it zapped and see how much gold we have.
All right, so we got rid of almost all the copper. There's about 0.5% of copper left. There's just a smidgen of bismuth left in there. But some of you guys may have noticed there's some selenium, and I think it's niobium is in there. And what happens oftentimes when you get elements in there that are weird or weren't in there at the beginning is the gun gets confused. And so it's probably either gold or silver that is reading as niobium and selenium. I can't tell you which one, though, but we ended up with probably in the neighborhood of 90% gold and roughly 10% silver. So that's in the 21 to 22 carat. But we took our rings and our bracelet, turned it into precious metals pretty much. So it worked well. It did exactly what we wanted it to do. I had to add a little bit more bismuth two or three more times to get the finish on the button that I wanted. The other thing that I will mention is this button is not worth any more than it was as jewelry now that we've refined it down, you know, 22 karat gold versus 14. And if we took it and, you know, dissolved it in acids and precipitated out the gold and ended up with 3/9 gold, it still wouldn't be any more valuable, because if I send this off to a refiner to get paid for it, they're going to give me 90% of the gold value, regardless of if it's 14 karat gold, 22 karat gold, or 24 karat gold. So it really doesn't matter. But I know a lot of you guys were really interested to see this video. It's kind of a unique way to purify the gold and the silver without using acids. You can do this at home. You can do this with a little propane furnace or the electric furnace like I have. So I hope you guys enjoyed this video. Let me know what you think about the overall process. And I tried to answer as many of the cupelling and smelting questions as I could that kind of come up oftentimes on my channel. So thanks again for watching, and we'll see you on the next video.